Hello YouTube, and welcome to Hidden Hacks.
First up, this is the continuation of part 1. I suggest that you watch it first if you haven't yet. Just click right here to check it out. On the second part of the series, we will discuss some things about the code changes and we will do some power draw and code testing. Also, huge thanks to the awesome folks who helped me out on the Arduino subreddit. Let's go! So I just received the new pair that I have ordered a few weeks ago. For comparison, the first noticeable difference is that the new pair doesn't have any sort of screw hole and the pinout is quite different as well. As you can see here, the pins of the matrix is ground, data, then 5 volts. This one is data, 5 volts, then ground. The location of the headers are different as well, and to be honest, it's easier to solder stuff on this one. Let's move on to soldering. This time, I'm going to use 45 degree pin headers since I think it would be easier that way. And now that it's done, let's connect it to the Arduino. The schematics or connections would remain the same. Arduino digital pin 2 to data in, Arduino 5 volts to 5 volts, and Arduino ground to ground. After that, let's check if it would work as intended by trying out some code. Okay, let's connect it to the computer. So, this is the code that we have used before on part 1. Double check if the board is being detected. There it is on COM 5. Click on build, then upload the code. Just gonna turn off the lights. There you go. Let's see then. Okay, looks like our code is working just fine. Now let's try some other codes then. Click on Home, Import Arduino Project, Use Libraries Installed by Arduino IDE, select the correct board, Arduino ATmega 328, Documents, Arduino, Libraries, NeoPixel Library, Examples, Animations, let's try Cylon. Click on Import, Include Arduino Library, change pixel count to 64, then click on Upload. There it is. Looks good. After that, let's re-upload the initial test code. So, the code is working fine and the matrix is working as intended. What we need to do now is find out how much current it uses on each symbol or sprite to confirm that the Arduino Nano can provide—
Hold it! We can clearly see that it's working properly even without a separate power supply for the matrix, so what's the point of doing it?
Well, in order for us to make sure that both the matrix and MCU would work without overheating, we need to take into account the current draw of the matrix, so that we can verify if it would put a strain on the Arduino or not. And to do that, we need to hook up the test probes that are connected to our multimeter. Hook these guys to the 5 volts and ground pin just like that. Let's see. The stop display or all red LEDs turned on is 30 milliamps. The go display is 30 milliamps as well. And according to the ATmega 328P datasheet, the absolute maximum ratings of the VCC and ground pins of the Nano is around 200 milliamps, which is 6.67 times higher than the current draw that we have right now. However, the current draw of the right arrow is around 35 to 40 milliamps. Left arrow is about just the same as the right one. Interesting. I'm not sure why the arrows draw more current, but I'm guessing that it's because of the color. See, even though we see the arrows as color red, it's really more of a dark orange of sorts according to its color value. But since we are way below the maximum rating, I think it's still on the safe side. Don't quote me on that though. After finding out the current draw of the matrix, let's try out the updated code. I have made some minor changes to make the code a little bit cleaner. Here, I will show you the similarities and minor differences of test code 2 to highlight the changes that I have made. This part right here is basically just the same, apart from the brightness value. Void setup is just the same as well, apart from the set brightness not being in test code 2. The main difference is inside the void loop. See, instead of including the functions inside the loop, I call it from outside the loop. For example, if analog read VX or left side of the joystick has a value of less than or equal to 50, it will call the left arrow blink statement, which will clear what's on the display, then show the left arrow symbol or sprite with a brightness level of 64 for about 500 milliseconds. Then disappear for about 500 milliseconds, then reappear again. The delay and clear function here represents the blinking effect. And the same thing goes for the rest of the code, except for the button. Alright, let's try it out. Using delay is just as fine, however, I would need to hold the joystick in order for it to blink. This type of code would be much more preferable if I have some sort of sensor that would detect if I turn right, left, or if I pulled on the brakes. So we're going to need to make some more changes to the code. So I tried to use blink without delay. But I got confused because the blink without delay example is for an LED diode. And my feeble potato brain can't figure out how to incorporate the FastLED code with it. It's a good thing that FastLED has its own version of the millis, called every n milliseconds, which is way easier to use. So that's what I use to make the symbols blink. Just a reminder that all the necessary links would be available on the description down below. After making some more changes, this is going to be the third and final version of the code as of now. And as I have said on part 1, I'm planning on adding more functions in the future. But for now, this would be good enough. Here's a quick comparison between test code 2, which has the delays, and the new one, which has FastLED millis. Just by looking at these things, it's obvious that the new code is a little bit longer. And in terms of how it works, it's a little bit the same with test code 2. However, this version of the code uses FastLED's version of millis instead of delays. I have also added some booleans. As you can see here, these are the same with the previous code. I have also added some comments to help understand the code better. Okay, so XL here is x-axis left, XR is x-axis right, YU is y-axis up, and YD is y-axis down. BT0 and BT1 are also here. Here's an example of how the code works. If analog read VX or analog pin 0's value is less than or equal to x-axis left, which has the value of 80, it would set the value of BT1 to true because it is unpushed. And then the value of XL to true as well. When XL is true, it will call left arrow blink. This one right here. This is the aforementioned every n milliseconds. I have set the FastLED millis to different values because something weird is happening when they are the same and I don't know why. So this would first clear what's on the display for about 500 milliseconds and then show the left arrow symbol with a brightness setting of 20. Clear the display, then show it again to imitate the blinking effect. Basically, without the millis and clear, it would just stay on or active. And that's it! The process is just the same for the following codes. Here is a demo of the new code. Unlike the one with the delay, this code makes the matrix blink even without keeping the joystick pointed to a certain direction. Now, let's do another test. This time, let's check out the current draw of both the matrix and Arduino Nano. On the first current draw test, I was using my case's front panel USB hub, and on this one, I'm going to use a power bank. By the way, this is my DIY 18,000 mAh power bank that can provide either 1 or 2 amps of current. Click right here to check it out. To check the current draw, I will use a USB multifunction tester. According to this, both the Arduino Nano and Matrix is drawing about 4.93 volts and 0.05 amps or 50 milliamps, which is just about right, I think. I mean, when using the multimeter earlier, it was showing that the Matrix is drawing about 35 to 40 milliamps. So that would mean the Arduino is drawing about 10 to 20 milliamps. In conclusion, we have finished version 3 of the code and we have established that both the Arduino Nano and LED matrix can be powered by a power bank without any issues. The only thing left to do now is find or create an enclosure for the matrix, repair my mountain bike, and wait for this COVID-19 epidemic to run its course. So yeah, that's it. Stay safe, thanks for watching, and see you again next week. Maybe.
Bye.